गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, माय नेम इज़ अप्सरा एंड वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल। सो फ्रेंड्स, टुडे वील बी डिस्कसिंग द सेकेंड चैप्टर ऑफ द स्नैपशॉट, दैट इज द एड्रेस। इट इज़ बाय मार्गा मिंको। लेट्स सी द इंट्रोडक्शन। दिस शॉर्ट स्टोरी इज अ पोएगन अकाउंट ऑफ अ डॉटर हु गोज इन सर्च ऑफ अ मदर्स बिलोंगिंग आफ्टर द वॉर इन होलैंड। व्हेन शी फाइंड्स देम, द ऑब्जेक्ट इवोक मेमोरीज ऑफ अर्लियर लाइफ। However, she decided to leave them all behind and resolved to move on. So this story is basically about the daughter who goes in search of her mother's belongings after the war. It is in Holland. And she finds the object evoke memories of her earlier life. And she finds the object and these objects bring back the memories of her earlier life. However, she decided to leave all these memories and move on. So let's start the lesson. Do you still know me? I asked. The woman looked at me searchingly. She had opened the door in a chink. I came closer and stood on the step. No, I don't know you. I am Miss S's daughter. She held her hand on the door as though she wanted to prevent it from opening any further. Her face gave absolutely no sign of recognition. She kept staring at me in silence. So the first paragraph here, the girl asks the woman if she knows her. And the woman opened the door. So the girl came closer and stood on the step. And the woman replies, she don't know you. She don't know that girl. So the girl replies, it's I am Miss S's daughter. And the woman held her hand on the door as though she wanted to prevent it from opening any further. She didn't want to let the visitor enter the house. And her face showed no signs of recognition. She did not recognize the girl. And she kept staring at the girl in silence. Perhaps I was mistaken, I thought. It isn't her. I had seen her only once, fleetingly, and that was years ago. It was the most probable time that I had rung the wrong bell. The woman let go of the door and stepped to the side. She was wearing my mother's green knitted cardigan. The wooden buttons were rather pale from washing. She saw that I was looking at the cardigan and half hid herself again behind the door. But I knew now that I was right. And next paragraph, it is talking. The girl says maybe she was mistaken. And she thought it wasn't her. She had only seen her once, fleetingly. That means very short time. Fleetingly means short time. And that was years ago. And she thought she had rung on the wrong bell. Probably she rang on the wrong bell. And the woman let go of the door and then stepped to the side. And then she was wearing the girl's mother's knitted cardigan. The wooden button, it looked pale from washing. And she saw that the girl was looking at the cardigan and half hid herself again behind the door. As the girl looked at her cardigan, half-knitted cardigan, she hid herself behind the door. But I knew now that I was right. But she knew she was right. The girl knew she was right. Well, you knew my mother? I asked. Have you come back? Said the woman. I thought that no one had come back. Only me. The girl asked if she knew her mother. The woman replies by saying, have you come back? She thought that no one had come back. The girl replies, only me. The door opened and closed in the passage behind her. A musty smell emerged. I regret I cannot do anything for you. I have come here specially on the train. I wanted to talk to you for a moment. It is not convenient for me now, said the woman. I can't see you another time. She nodded and cautiously closed the door as though no one inside the house should be disturbed. I stood where I was on the step. The curtain in front of the bay window moved. Someone stared at me and would have been asked what I wanted. Oh, nothing, the woman should have said. It was nothing. So here the door opened and closed in the passage behind her. And the musty smell. And there was musty smell. It emerged. The musty smell emerged. Musty smell emerged. Musty here means damp smell. Damp, very damp smell. And she says, I regret, that she regrets and she cannot do anything for her, for the girl. And the girl replies, I've come specially on the train. She came here on the train and she wanted to talk to her for a moment. It is not convenient for me now, the woman replies. I can't see you, she kindly says. It is not convenient time for her and she can't see the girl another time. And she nodded cautiously and closed the door as though no one inside the house should be disturbed. So she closed the door slowly and then as though like no one should be disturbed in the home. And she stood where she was on the step. The curtain in front of the bay window moved. And then someone stared at me and would then have asked what I wanted. Oh, nothing, the woman would have said. It was nothing. If anyone stared at her, someone stared at her and then they would have asked what I wanted, what she wanted. Then the woman would have said, oh, nothing. It was nothing. I looked at the nameplate again. Darling, it said in black letters on white enamel. And on the jamb, a big higher, the number 46. And she looked at the nameplate of the house. And it said, darling. It was written in black letters on a white enamel. And on the jamb, a bit higher. The number was 46. I looked at the nameplate again. As I walked slowly back to the station, I thought about my mother who had given me the address years ago. It had been in first half of the war. I was home for a few days and it struck me immediately that something or the other about the rooms had been changed. I missed various things. My mother was surprised. I should have noticed so quickly. Then she told me about Mrs. Darling. I had never heard of her, but apparently she was an old acquaintance of my mother, whom she hadn't seen for years. She had suddenly turned up and renewed her contract. Since then, she had come home regularly. As I walked slowly back to the station, I thought about my mother who had given me the address years ago. And it had been the first half of the war. And the girl is walking back to the station. And she thought about her mother who gave her the address years ago. And it was the first half of the war. And she was home for a few days. And it struck her immediately that something or the other about the rooms had changed. I missed various things. She missed the various things. And her mother was surprised. I should have noticed so quickly. And she should have noticed it so quickly. Then she told me about Mrs. Darling. I had never heard about her. Apparently, she was an old acquaintance of my mother. She was like an old friend of the mother. And I had never heard of her. Apparently, she was an old acquaintance of my mother. And she hadn't seen for few years. She had suddenly turned up and renewed their contact. Since then, she had come regularly. Every time she leaves here, she takes something home with her, said my mother. She took all the table silver in one go, and then the antique plates that hung there. She had bought trouble lugging those large vases, and I'm worried she got a crick in her back from the crockery. My mother shook her head pityingly. I would never have dared ask her. She suggested it to me, to herself. She even insisted she wanted to save all my nice things. If we have to live here, we shall lose everything, she says. And every time she lives here, so she's telling every time Miss Dorling lives here, she takes something with her. And one time Miss Dorling took all the table silver in one go. And then the antique plates. She even took the antique plates. And then she had trouble lugging those large vases. And the mother was worried because she thought Dorling got a crick in her back from the crockery. She got a crick feeling in her back from the crockery. A stiff pain in the back or in the neck. Stiff, crick means stiff pain. My mother shook her head pityingly. She would have never dared asked her. She suggested it to her daughter herself. And she even insisted. She wanted to save all the nice thing. And if they were to leave the house, and they shall lose everything, she says. Have you agreed with her that she should keep everything? I asked. Have you agreed with her? As if that's necessary, my mother cried. It would simply be an insult to talk like that. And think about the risk she's running. Each time she goes out of our door with a full suitcase or a bag. And the daughter asked, have you ever agreed with her that she could keep everything? Is it in your concern she's taking things? But the mother replies, saying, as if that is necessary. That's necessary. She cried and said, it would be simply an insult to talk like that. She's saying it would be an insult to talk to Miss Dorling like that. It would be an insult to talk back to Miss Dorling like that. And think about the risk she's running each time she goes out of her door with full suitcase or bag. My mother seemed to notice that I was not entirely convinced. She looked at me reprovingly, and after that we spoke no more about it. Meanwhile, I had arrived at the station without having paid much attention to things on the way. I was walking in a familiar place again, and for the first time since the war. But I did not want to go further than was necessary. I did not want to upset myself with the sight of street and houses full of memories from a precious time. In the train back, I saw Miss Dorling in front of me again as I had the first time I met her. It was the morning after the day my mother had told me about her. I had got up late and coming down stairs. I saw my mother about to see someone out, a woman with a broad back. There is my daughter, said my mother. She beckoned to me. The woman nodded and picked up the suitcase under the coat rack. She wore a brown coat and a shapeless hat. Does she live far away? I asked. Seeing the difficulty she had going out of the house with a heavy case. In Macaroni Street, said my mother. Number 46, remember that. So, her mother noticed that her daughter was fully not convinced regarding Dolly, Miss Darling, sorry, Miss Darling. Darling. And she looked reapprovingly, and after that they spoke no more about it. And meanwhile, she had arrived at the station having not paid much attention to the things on the way. And she was walking in the similar places. Again, after the war, she walked to the same places. But she did not want to go further than was necessary. She did not upset herself, thinking of the streets and houses full of memories from a precious time. And at the train, she saw Miss Darling in the front of her. Again, first time she had met her. It was the morning after the day her mother had told about her. And she got up very late, and coming downstairs, she saw her mother about to see someone out. A woman with a broad back. There is my daughter, my mother said. She beckoned to me. The woman nodded and picked up the suitcase under the coat rack. She wore a brown coat and a shapeless hat. So, this is about Miss Darling. And she says, there is my daughter. And then she beckoned to me. The woman just nodded and picked up the suitcase under the coat rack. She wore a brown coat and a shapeless hat. Does she live far away? I asked, seeing the difficulty she had going out of the house with a heavy case. In Macaroni Street, my mother, number 46, remember that? I had remembered it, but I had waited a long time to go there. Initially, after the liberation, I was absolutely not interested in all that stored stuff. And naturally, I was also rather afraid of it. Afraid of being confronted with things that had belonged to a connection that no longer existed. They were hidden away in cupboards and boxes, waiting in vain until they were put back in the place again, which had endured all those years because they were things. And she is telling she had remembered it, and she had waited a long time to go there, initially after the liberation. And she was absolutely not interested in all the stored stuff. And naturally, she was rather afraid of it. She was not interested or afraid of it. And afraid of being confronted with the things that had belonged to a connection that no longer exists. She's telling, afraid of being confronted, afraid of being faced with the things that belonged to a connection that no longer existed, that belonged to some time through a connection which no longer existed, which were hidden away in cupboard and boxes. And they were hidden away in the cupboards and boxes, waiting in vain. Waiting in anger, they put back in their places, and which had endured all those years because they were the things. But gradually everything became more normal again. Bread was getting to be lighter color. There was a bed you could sleep in under, unthreatened, a room with a view you were more used to glancing at each day. And one day I noticed I was curious about all the possessions that must still be at that address. I wanted to see them, touch, remember. After my first visit to Wayne, in vain to Mrs. Darling's house, I decided to try a second time. Now a girl about 15 opened the door to me. I asked her if her mother was at home. No, she said. My mother's doing an errand. No matter, I said. I'll wait for her. So, she's telling everything became normal again. And the bread was getting lighter in color and there was bed you could sleep unthreatened without any fear. They had bread and then bed. And one day she was curious about the possession that must be still at the address, about all the things that was at the address, and she wanted to see them and touch and remember all those memories and the possessions. And after her first visit in vain to Miss Darling's house, She decided to go to Miss Darling's house second time. And this time it was a girl of 15 opened the door. And she asked if her mother was at home. The girl replied, the girl about 15 years, Mrs. Darling's daughter, she replied no, and she's saying mother's doing an errand, the short thing which is about to deliver us. No matter, she said she will wait for her. I followed the girl along the passage. An old-fashioned iron Hanukkah candle holder hung next to the mirror. We never used it because it was much more cumbersome than a single candlestick. I followed the girl along the passage. An old-fashioned iron Hanukkah held a candle holder hung next to the mirror. We never used it because it was much more cumbersome than a single candlestick. And she followed the girl along the passage. An old-fashioned Hanukkah, a candle holder, was next to the mirror. And they never used it because it was cumbersome. It was very heavy. It was more than heavy than a single candlestick. "Won't you sit down?" asked the girl. She opened the door of a living room and I went inside past her. I stopped horrified. I was in a room I knew and did not know. I found myself in the midst of things I did not want to see again, but which oppressed me in the strange atmosphere. All because of the tasteless way everything was arranged. All because of the ugly furniture, of the muggy smell that hung there. I did not know, but I scarcely dared to look around me. The girl moved a chair. I sat down and stared at the woolen tablecloth. I rubbed it. My fingers grew warm from rubbing. I followed the lines of the pattern somewhere on the edge, and there should be a burn mark that had never been repaired. "Won't you sit down?" the girl asked, and she opened the door of the living room, and she went inside past her, and she stopped horrified. And she was in a room she did not know, and she found herself in the middle of things she didn't want to see again, or oppressed me in the same atmosphere, or because of the tasteless way everything was arranged. It was arranged in a different way, all the furniture and her possessions, because of the ugly furniture or the muggy smell that hung there. Maybe it was because of the furniture or the muggy smell that hung there. She didn't know, and she scarcely dared to look around her. The girl moved in a chair and she sat down and stared at the woolen tablecloth, and she rubbed it. Her fingers grew warm from rubbing, and she followed the lines of the pattern. Somewhere on the edge there should be a burn mark that never been repaired. "My mother will be back soon," said the girl. "I've already made tea for her. Will you have a cup?" "Thank you." I looked up. The girl put cups ready on the tea table. She had a broad back, just like her mother. She poured tea from a white pot. All it had was a gold border on the lid. I remembered she opened a box and took some spoons out. And she looked up. The girl put cups ready on the tea table. And she had a broad back. So the girl is now serving the tea, and she put two cups on the tea table, and then she had a broad back, just like the mother. And she poured tea from the white pot, and all it had was gold border on the lid. The teacup had a gold border on the lid. Description of the teacup. And she remembered that she opened a box and took some spoons out. "That's a nice box. I've heard my mother's own voice." It was a strange voice, although each sound was different in this room. "Oh, you knew about them?" She had turned around and brought my tea. She laughed. "My mother says it's antique. We've got lots more." She pointed around the room. "See for yourself." "And she says it's a nice box." She heard her own voice. It was a strange voice, although each sound was different in the room. Her own voice. She felt her own voice as different and strange, although there was different voices in the room. "Oh, you know about them." She had turned around and brought me my tea. The girl asked, "You know about them?" And she turned around and bought her the tea. And she laughed and she said that She laughed and she said that it is antique and we got lots more. She pointed the room around the room and then she asked to see for herself. See for yourself. I had no need to follow her aunt. I knew which thing she meant. I just looked at the still life over the tea table. As a child, I had always fancied the apple on the pewter plate. We use it for everything, she said. Once we even ate off the plates hanging there on the wall. I wanted so much more, but it wasn't anything special. I had found the burn mark on the tablecloth. The girl looked questioningly at me. Yes, I said. You get so used to touching all these lovely things in the house, you hardly look at them anymore. So she's telling she had no need to follow her aunt, and she knew the things which she meant. And she looked at all the still life over the tea table. As a child, she always fancied the apple on the pewter plate. And we use it for everything. They use it for everything, she said. Once we even ate off the plates hanging there on the wall. And she wanted it so bad, but it wasn't anything special. And she found the burn mark on the tablecloth. The girl looked questioningly at me. So the girl looked questioningly at the girl. At me. Yes, I said. You get so used to touching all these lovely things in the house. She said, yeah, you get so used to touching all the things in the house. And you hardly look at them anymore. You only notice when something is missing. So she's telling you get used to touching all the lovely things in the house. So you hardly look at them anymore. You are used to it. So she's used to touching all the things. So she hardly looks at them. So she only notices when something is missing. Because it had to be repaired or you have to lend it. For example. Again, I heard the unnatural sound of my voice. I went on. I remember my mother once asked me if I would help her polish the silver. It was a very long time ago and I was probably bored the day or perhaps I had to stay at home because I was ill. And she had never asked me before. I asked her which silver she meant and she replied, surprised. It was the spoons, forks and the knives, of course. And that was a strange thing. I didn't know the cutlery we ate off every day was silver. And she's saying again, it was unnatural sound of the voice. And she went on. And she remember her mother once asked it would help her to polish the silver. But it was very long time ago and she was very bored that day. Or perhaps she had to stay at home because she was ill. And she never asked me before. Like she never asked the girl before. And she asked her which silver she meant. And she replied surprised. It was a silver spoon, forks and knives. So the mother was talking about the silver spoons, forks and knives, of course. And that was a strange thing. She did not know the cutlery we ate off every day was silver. The girl laughed again. I begged. You don't know it is either. I looked at her intently at her. What we eat with? She asked. Well, do you know? She hesitated. She walked to the sideboard and wanted to open a drawer. I look, it's in here. So the girl laughed and she's saying, I bet. She bet. She don't know. The girl didn't know either. I looked up intently at her. What we eat with? She asked. And then, well, do you know? She asked. But she hesitantly walked to the sideboard and wanted to open the drawer. I look, it's in here, and she said. I jumped up. I was forgetting the time. I must catch my train. She had her hand on the drawer. Don't you want to wait for my mother? No, I must go. I walked to the door. The girl pulled the drawer open. I can find my own way. I walked down the passage. I heard the jingling of the spoons and the forks. So she hesitated and then she walked to the sideboard and wanted to open a drawer. I look, it's in here. And she jumped and she was forgetting the time. It was time for her to catch her train. And she had her hand at the drawer and she asked, "Don't you want to look for my mother?" "No, I must go." I walked to the door and the girl pulled the drawer open and she said she can find her own way. So she walked down the passage and she heard the jingling of the spoons and the fork. At the corner of the road, I looked up the nameplate. Marconi Street, it said. Marconi Street, it said. I had been at number 46. The address was correct, but now I didn't want to remember it anymore. It wouldn't go back because objects are linked in your memory with the familiar lives of former times instantly lose their value when severed from them. You see them again in a strange surrounding. And what should I have done with them in a small rented room where the shreds of blackout paper was hung along the windows and no more than a handful of cutlery fitted in the narrow table drawer? So she's telling at the corner of the road she looked at the nameplate and Marconi Street, it said, and the number is 46, so the address was correct. But she didn't want to remember it anymore because she didn't want to go back there and see the object, her possessions, she valued so much. And it was linked to her memory with the familiar life of former times. Instantly lose their value when severed from them. As you see them in a strange surroundings. The possessions which you valued so much in her time will definitely lose her value when you see them in a strange surroundings. So, and what would she have done with them in a small surrounding? Sorry, what she would have done with them in a small rented room with a shred of blackout paper hung along the windows and no more than a handful of cutlery fitted in the narrow table drawer. I resolved to forget the address. I resolved to forget the address. Of all the things I had to forget, that would be the easiest. So she resolved. She resolved means firmly determined to do something, to forget about the address. Of all the things she had to forget, that would be the easiest. And this is a lesson, the address. So hope you guys understood the lesson and feel free to comment and like and share the video even to your friends, and it would mean a lot. And if there is any error in my explanation, please do mention in the comment box. I would correct myself. And thank you for listening to my class, and make sure to subscribe, like and share.